the last 2 weeks. Beating two of the great teams that's in our league. But you got something coming. As long as you play like you're playing, good things will happen to us. Good things will happen to us.
Ole Miss head coach Billy Brewer's postgame talk summed it up. For 2 weeks straight, the Rebels have battled top 20-ranked SEC teams, Auburn and Georgia, on even terms, but still came away with a loss. But the times, they are a-changing. All the highlights and interviews of Ole Miss against Georgia up next on The Billy Brewer Show. I'm Ken Anderson, and welcome to week number 6 of the Billy Brewer Show, the Ole Miss Rebels against the Georgia Bulldogs. Now, first of all, I'd like to relate a little incident to you that happened Saturday morning. Walking into Georgia Stadium, overheard a Georgia fan telling someone else, "Well, I guess it's about time we brought Ole Miss back down to earth." You know, I thought about that a little bit, and that indicated to me that he and probably a lot of the Georgia fans maybe felt like Ole Miss's 3-1-1 record going into the game was a bit of a fluke, and that maybe they also thought that the Rebels were playing above their heads this year, especially against Auburn. Now, Georgia did beat Ole Miss Saturday. The final score was 18-12, but I'll guarantee you one thing. When those Georgia fans left that stadium Saturday afternoon, they knew firsthand that the Ole Miss Rebels are not a fluke and that they are for real this year. The past two games, they played top 20-ranked Auburn and Georgia even up, no intimidation whatsoever. And on a given day, the Rebels can now honestly play with anybody. If Ole Miss had won this game, that wouldn't have been an upset to you, would it?
It wouldn't have been upset to me. It wouldn't have been upset to the rest of the guys in here. You know, it probably would have been to the general public, but, you know, we felt like we were going to win.
Everybody else around the country would have thought it was an upset, but, you know, that's them. We figured we're, you know, as good, you know, or better than the teams we're playing. So we don't, the games we win, we don't consider upsets.
We have come an awful long way, and I'm, and that's in demonstrating what we have done in the last 2 weeks against two very fine programs. But, you know, that's not the season. That's not what we want. We want to win, and we want to play well, and we want to do the other things that goes along with it.
Now, statistically, in Saturday's game, Georgia had a tremendous edge in rushing, and the Ole Miss Rebels had a tremendous advantage in passing. And that simply indicates what was successful for each team as the game unfolded. Now, in the passing department, Rebel quarterback Kent Austin's arm really got a workout Saturday. Kent put it up 41 times. He completed 22. That's over 50% for 192 yards passing. So in total offense, the Rebels finished with 251 yards, while the Georgia Dogs had 339. First downs were just about dead even, Georgia 17 and Ole Miss 16. Tell you what, it was a mighty funny game Saturday. A lot of funny bounces, a lot of funny twists and turns and momentum shifts. So stay with us right where you are. We have got it all the action and all the post-game interviews right here on The Billy Brewer Show.
The Billy Brewer Show is brought to you by Brian Foods, Coca-Cola, Lennox Air Conditioning, Heilemann's Old Style, and Mississippi Chemical.
And by Eastern Airlines, Kentucky Fried Chicken, Jindy Jungle, and Pioneer Chainsaws.
A capacity crowd over 82,000 enjoyed a beautiful day and a white knuckler of a game as the Ole Miss Rebels and the top 20-ranked Georgia Bulldogs battled it out even up in Athens, GA. On its second possession of the day, the Georgia Bulldogs staged a methodical, time-consuming Georgia drive. Third and 6, junior quarterback Todd Williams rode out, spotted split end Herman Archie, a 10-yard completion to the Ole Miss 35.
Two plays later, running back Andre Smith gets the call up the middle, 6 yards down to the 24. So the Rebel defense bent, but it didn't break. Dogs pushed down to the 11, where Ole Miss put on the stop. Third down, Williams rolled out, kept. Not enough for the first down, though, so Kevin Butler came in for the field goal attempt. It was a 23-yarder, so Georgia got on the board first, 3-0 at the 5:09 mark of the opening quarter. But the Dogs only netted 3 points instead of seven off a drive that lasted over 6.5 minutes. On the Rebels' next possession, Ole Miss continued to suffer the offensive frustrations and inconsistency, moving the ball great between the 20s, but failing to put points on the board. Freshman running back Joe Mickles got the draw, good inside running, got the first down at the 45. Three plays later, it's third and two from the 47. Quarterback Ken Austin with a quick pass to split in Timmy Moffitt, who spins for 12 yards, and the first down at the 35. But on the next third down situation, Austin drops back. Georgia brings in the heavy rush on the play, and Ken is dropped for a loss, killing the drive.
We had a difficult time, and it was frustrating, and they were frustrated. But that's some things that we'll get better with and learn to handle better and do a better job of it. But there again, I think the opponent also has something to do with how you produce in those situations too.
Yeah, it was frustrating. You know, we're not scoring enough points. You know, our defense is really playing good, and we just got to find a way to score. You know, we had.
Like you said, it's frustrating, but, you know, that's been our problem, you know, the past two ball games. We moved the ball well against Auburn, moved the ball pretty well against Georgia, but when we get down there in the scoring range, you know, that something happens, and I don't know, we just got to go to practice and work those things out.
So the first quarter ends with Georgia's field goal, the only points on the board, Georgia 3, Ole Miss nothing. In the second period, the Rebel defense continued to show why it's ranked among the national leaders in several categories. Georgia freshman running back Cleveland Gary carried for 18 yards here. But when it was time to get serious, the Rebels did. Third and three at the 24. And Gary is stopped a yard short of the first down. So the Dogs go for it on fourth and one, but a good surge by the defensive front stopping Lars Tate for no gain whatsoever. Defense hanging tough.
Were you surprised at all in their offense, anything they did?
No, everything they did, the things we went over in practice. So, you know, it wasn't anything new. They just busted a couple big plays on us.
How do you feel right now?
I feel that overall we played a good game. We just didn't get our breaks at the time we needed them.
Now, late in the second quarter, Rebel offense finally got a break it needed. Less than a minute 30 left in the half, Georgia forced a punt. Senior split in Timmy Moffitt, the return man. Moffitt took the punt around the 38. He broke through the Georgia coverage, good run, and scampered up the right sideline for 24 yards. The good return of 24 yards and a 15-yard penalty tacked on against the Bulldogs gave Ole Miss great field position at the 29-yard line. Then on the first play, Austin drops back and dumps it off to number 21, tailback Quentin Pitts. The redshirt freshman out of Jackson, Mississippi makes a good freight train run for 16 yards, first down at the 13. Rebs lose 3 yards on the next two plays, so third down at the 16. Kent throws for Moffitt in the end zone. The Georgia defender jumps into Timmy. Pass interference the call, and the ball is spotted at the 2. So it's third and goal. Austin lobs a pass to Moffitt in the end zone. Three different angles appear to show Moffitt in control and feet in bounds.
You know, we talked, I asked him if he caught him, was he in bounds? And he said, yeah, there's no question. But, you know, on our point of view, you know, we're going to say he's in, you know, and if it's anywhere close, Timmy's going to say that he was in. You know, of course, the rest just saw it differently.
We don't officiate. The guy calls it like he sees it, and that's the way it goes down. I wish it would have counted, and it would have helped us some, but who knows? It may not have. They might have scored 4 or 5 more, and we couldn't have done anything about it.
Rebels did get a field goal out of it, though. John Howard came in and booted a 23-yarder with 12 seconds on the clock to tie the game at 3 apiece. So with only seconds left in the half, the 82,000 fans expected a 3-3 tie at the break, but there was more to come. Rebels' Bill Smith kicks off, and Georgia's return man Andre Smith bobbles the ball, and Joe Nathan Shelley, the sophomore out of Vicksburg, pounces on it at the 2-yard line. With the recovery by Joe Nathan Shelley, it'll be Ole Miss's ball, 10 seconds left in the half. But with no timeouts left, Coach Brewer opts for the surefire 3 points. John Howard boots the 18-yarder, and the Rebels take a 6-3 lead.
Well, there's no question of mine. I go for a field goal every time. You know, we don't have any timeouts. 10 seconds left. We can, you know, fumble a snap from center, or a guy gets hit, and they'll hold us down, and we can't get the ball off to run a field goal team on the field in that length of time.
So in the final 12 seconds of the half, Ole Miss gets 2 field goals and led Georgia 6-3 at the break.
You know, when it gets to halftime, whether you're in the stands or the press box or wherever, everybody's ready for some refreshment, something to drink, a Coke or something. And if we're ready for some refreshment, just imagine what the players must feel like after the first half of play, especially in some hot weather or something. Now, the weather in Athens Saturday was steamy, sunny, and mighty hot down on the field. So this week, our halftime feature centers on the folks who make sure the players can take that heat. Tom Ryland has the story.
These fans were working overtime during the Ole Miss-Georgia game, and the liquids were going fast. After all, a bulky lineman can lose as much as 15 pounds in weather like this. Dehydration is just one of the concerns of the trainers and doctors who pace the sidelines every weekend. Dr. Robert Cooper, one of the team's traveling physicians, says a team like Ole Miss takes the heat pretty well.
They're very well conditioned, and we really have had very little trouble with it this year. It's quite remarkable. I think that playing on the grass helps.
You'll see the student trainers on the Rebel sideline making some good moves. They're supervised by head trainer Leroy Mullins and his assistant trainer, Jojo Petroni. Jojo doesn't just treat the wounded.
I like to get involved in the game. It's part of the things that the players really like when they're down. You got to boost them, pat them on the butt, give them confidence. That's what they need. They don't need anybody telling them they're doing bad. Even though they do something bad, it's important for them to keep positive thinking. That's what I like to be, positive motivator.
Otherwise mild-mannered doctors also catch the Rebel spirit.
Well, the first year I was here, I thought it might be good to look cool and professional, but I know the football players know that we can work just as well whether we lead cheers or not, so we get into the game down here. We're all for the Rebels.
The doctors and trainers who week in and week out keep a close watch on the Ole Miss athletes are their biggest fans and best friends. This is Tom Ryland for the Billy Brewer Show.
The Ole Miss Rebels owned a 6-3 lead entering the second half of play, but Vince Dooley's Bulldogs would quickly change that with a 70-yard drive and only 6 plays. This got it started. Freshman quarterback David Dukes replacing the injured starter Todd Williams. Dukes with the throwback to the tight end who romped for 23 yards up the near sideline. That brought up a first down at the Ole Miss 44. One play later, junior tailback Tron Jackson took the quick pitch around the right side for 12 yards down to the 28-yard line. And from there, Dukes rolls out left, lofts a soft pass to Cassius Osborne at the goal line. Osborne outleaps Barry Wilburn for the good catch. 28-yard touchdown pass, extra point good, and the Bulldogs had retaken the lead 10-6.
Well, you know, we knew they might score a touchdown. You know, defense to try to hold them under 20 points, you know. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we didn't have no downfall after they made that touchdown. We just gave us the motivation to come back and try to catch up and score on them again.
Rebs are stopped on the next possession, but they get a big break on the punt. Bill Smith gets off a beauty, a 56-yarder. The return man, Freddie Lane, bobbles the catch. The Rebel coverage swarms in, and Sam Albritt, number 99, recovers at the Georgia 24-yard line. So Ole Miss with brand new opportunity. First play, Kent drops back, fires a bullet to Timmy Moffitt at the 9-yard line. He stretches for about 2 more. Completion coverage, 17 yards in all. First down at the 7-yard line, Austin to Moffitt. Then freshman running back Joe Mickles got the call on first down. Good surge by the offensive line. Mickles gets 4 yards to the 3. Drive stalled, though. John Howard came in for a 19-yard field goal attempt. This one was wide, his first miss of the day, so the Rebs were still trailing the Georgia Dogs 10-6. But an upcoming series of turnovers gave Ole Miss another big break. Next possession, Rebels in the midst of a good drive. Option left, Mickles takes the pitch from Austin, turns the corner for 12 yards to midfield. 2 plays later, Austin, back to pass this time, spots the day's leading receiver, Timmy Moffitt, for 13 yards to the 36. Slow-mo on the pass from Austin to Moffitt. Timmy grabbed 5 catches for 81 yards on the afternoon. Soon, Austin and Moffitt try to hook up again, but this time the pass is intercepted. Georgia takes over, good interception at their own 32-yard line. But the Bulldogs wouldn't have it very long. On their second play, running back Cleveland Gary loses the handle, and the Rebels' Mike Fitzsimmons jumps on the ball at the Georgia 12-yard line. Linebackers Dan Boyce and Freddie Huddleston in on the initial hit, and Mike Fitzsimmons gets the recovery. Now, first play of the drive. Fullback Arthur Humphrey, who gained 31 yards against the Dogs, tried it over right guard. Florida senior got 4 yards. One play later, Kent faked the dive to Humphrey, then spotted tight end Steve Joyner all alone in the end zone. Rebels touchdown, and they led Georgia 12-10.
You know, we run a lot of dive on the goal line. You know, we try to wedge them out of there. And we just faked that and released Steve, hoping that the free safety who had him manned would bite on the dive, which he did, and it left Steve open the end zone.
And the Rebels quickly get another golden opportunity for some more points. Georgia's next series, Duke's pass is tipped by Freddie Huddleston. It pops high in the air, and sophomore safety Everett Flakes leaps for the interception, his first of the season. That gave Ole Miss the ball at Georgia's 48. Rebs couldn't move, though, had to punt. And the third quarter ended with Ole Miss still in the lead, 12-10. Early in the final quarter now, Georgia begins a critical drive, all on the ground. On the option play, Tron Jackson takes the pitch, makes a good run for 11 yards. The Bulldogs just grounded out the entire drive. Several plays later, Cleveland Gary spins over right guard for 7 yards. Gary was Georgia's leading rusher on the day with 98 yards, and he got the call here. From 6 yards out, he works his way over the goal line for the touch. 2-point conversion good, so the Georgia Bulldogs retake the lead over the Rebels 18-12 with 8:45 left in the game. But the Rebel offense quickly rises to the occasion and puts together a drive that had all 82,000 fans on the edge of their seats. 3rd and 9, Kent connects with clutch tight end Steve Joyner, good for 11 yards. Rebs were having their most success in the air, so they kept it up. This pass going to flanker James Harbor. Harbor, number 25, the senior out of Meridian, getting past midfield to the Georgia 49. One play later, Rebels face a 3rd and 6, but Austin's arm and Moffitt's hands kept the drive alive once again. A 14-yard completion down to the Georgia Bulldog 40. But the biggest third down was still yet to come. Kent was sacked twice, forcing a 3rd and 20 from midfield. The junior quarterback rode left, threw deep for Moffitt. The senior from Taylorsville made a super catch, play covered 25 yards, good for a first down at the 25. But 4 plays later, it was 4th and 4 from the 19-yard line. Kent dropped back, tried for Moffitt in the end zone, but it was knocked away. So Georgia took over. But the Rebels got the ball back one more time with 2 minutes left in the game. Final play for the Rebs. This was 4th and 4. Fans hoping the Austin-Moffitt connection would work one more time. Cornerback Tony Fleck and Moffitt both went for the ball, but on a controversial call, when they hit the ground, the officials rule an interception. The slow motion replay on the call, Moffitt and Fleck both going for the ball. Officials ruled the interception, and that was the game as the Bulldogs run out the clock.
We had a chance there at the close to the end of the fourth quarter where they say Kent threw an interception. I don't know about that. I think if it was a turning point in the game, it was at that part of the game right there, at the end there.
We had an opportunity to win the football game, and I thought we know it. Maybe today that we were possibly the better football team, but you've got to get your base hit, and we came up short on some of those things.
So the final score, the Georgia Bulldogs 18 and the Ole Miss Rebels 12.
So the Ole Miss Rebels are now 3-2-1 overall on the year, while the Georgia Bulldogs improved their overall record to 4-1. You know, I've noticed this season after the game in the locker room, one of the players who gets involved in the game as much as anybody, whether it be a win or a loss, is Coach Brewer's son, Brett Brewer. Brett, of course, transferred to Ole Miss when his dad took over as head coach, and we recently talked with Brett about the transfer and about playing under his dad.
Everybody most asks me why I like to play for my dad. I think there's a lot of reasons. He's a great coach for one. And another thing is he's my father. And we've always been pretty close, but I believe playing for him has made me a lot closer to him. It makes it doubly hard sometimes because you want to do so well that sometimes he might press a little bit. I try to put that out of my mind and basically go out there and just play the best of my ability. And I guess it's doubly pleasing that you do something well, not only for your father, but for your coach. The reason I transferred to Ole Miss, I guess I was getting a little stale at Louisiana Tech. I'd accomplished everything I could there. You know, SEC football is the best college football in America. It's always been a dream of mine to play here at Ole Miss, and I'm glad I got the opportunity to do it. Ole Miss has meant so much to me in 2 years. The people here have treated me better than I could hope to expect anywhere. It's been a place that I guess gave me a new start, and I'll never forget the rest of my life.
Ole Miss is a very special place. You meet a lot of fun people, a lot of neat people, and people that'll be your friends for the rest of your life.
I think the size actually makes Ole Miss a lot more personal.
The people, it makes it special and really nice.
I think it's one of the finest universities in the South.
It's just an atmosphere about it. Ole Miss, it's just great.
It's just special. It's like a second home.
Now let's look ahead to next week when the Ole Miss Rebels will travel down to Jackson, Mississippi to take on the Southern Mississippi Golden Eagles. Game time will be 1:30. That game will be in Jackson's Memorial Stadium. Ought to be a sellout crowd on hand, big crowd for the game. The two in-state rivals, Ole Miss against Southern Mississippi. Again, game time 1:30 Saturday afternoon. Now, the Golden Eagles still have several players that were involved in last year's game. The quarterback, Robert Duxworth, still on the team. Good runner, good passer. And the starting tailback is still Sam Desjarnette. Of course, last year's game, Southern defeated Ole Miss here in Oxford. The final score, 27-7. Now, as to how Southern is doing this year, well, in all honesty, the Golden Eagles kind of in the midst of a disappointing season. 1-5 on the year, that after Saturday night's loss to Tulane. That was down in New Orleans in the Superdome. Tulane won that game over Southern, final score, 35-7. So the Golden Eagles will come into the game against Ole Miss Saturday in Jackson with an overall record of 1-5. Of course, Ole Miss is 3-2-1. So that's the matchup Saturday, Ole Miss against Southern. Hope you'll join us for all the highlights next week and be at the game. Hope it's a sellout crowd. For head coach Billy Brewer and all the Rebels, I'm Ken Anderson. See you next week.
The Billy Brewer Show has been brought to you by Brian Foods, Coca-Cola, Lennox Air Conditioning, Heilemann's Old Style, and Mississippi Chemical.
And by Eastern Airlines, Kentucky Fried Chicken, Jindy Jungle, and Pioneer Chainsaws.